none can overthrow. Round his standard ranging, victory is secure. For his truth unchanging makes the triumph sure. Joyfully enlisting, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Savior, we are thine. Amen. Maybe you have been buffeted and beaten this week. Maybe you have wrestled and fought and been victorious. Maybe you're up against a wall, but the Lord is with you and the Lord cares. And he will never leave us nor forsake us. No man will pluck us out of his hand. Amen. Well, he's begun a good work in us, Philippians 1:6, right? And he's going to continue that. He's going to complete that in our lives. He's going to continue that until the day of Jesus Christ. And we are warriors, not that we're fighting people, but we are in a spiritual battle of good against evil and God's people against the devil. Well, last week we were talking about the heart and talking about treasures, the parable of the rich fool, and what we really value. We had talked about the parable of the treasure hidden in a field and how we are God's treasure. We are precious to him, and he paid the price to make us his. We also talked about the rich fool, that he had much goods laid up in store for many years to come. Take your rest. Take your ease. Eat. Drink, he said to his soul. Be merry. The Lord said, you fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Very serious. And so, as we think about our treasure, as we look into our treasure chest of our heart, what is our treasure? Is it our things? Is it other people? Is it what we do? Is it pleasure and enjoyment? Is it taking our rest, taking eating and drinking and being merry? Or is it the Lord? And the Lord is our treasure. And we can have everything, but without the Lord, we have nothing. And with the Lord, we have everything, no matter if we have nothing, because we have the Lord. But the devil wants to take that out of our lives. And he is after you to change your priorities. He is after you and he's after me to tempt us, to draw us astray, that the Lord would not be our treasure. If you have your Bible, and would turn to Ephesians chapter 6 with me. Ephesians 6. If you have your bulletin right there and would like to take that out, I have some fill in the blank. The colored words on the screen will be the ones that you put in the blank, if I did everything right, and kind of trace along where we're at and add to some things to take with you. The challenge this morning, to prepare for battle. Prepare for battle. Prepare for the fight. If we just sit back, we're going to be, as it were, like Pearl Harbor. Pearl Harbor was attacked December 7th, 1941. Just a few hours later, Clark Airfield in the Philippines was attacked, and the entire air wing dedicated to defending the Philippines and American interests in Asia was destroyed. Singapore was attacked just a few days after the Pearl Harbor attack, and His Majesty's Service, Prince of Wales, and His Majesty's Service, Repulse, were sunk outside of the Singapore harbor on December 10th. How could such a strong military power as the United States and Great Britain be destroyed so thoroughly and so quickly? Have you ever watched the film Pearl Harbor? Then you can get a picture of why this happened. Sailors and military personnel in Hawaii prior to the Japanese invasion were living as if there was no real enemy. Let me say that again. They were living as if there was no real enemy. It was a beautiful place. The waves lapped against the side of the ship. The sun shone. The sunsets were just beautiful. They were not expecting to be attacked. The Japanese were engaged in a massive deception to convince the U.S. that Japan was seeking peace, all the while planning, preparing, and then carrying out war. Japan was an enemy set on destroying the U.S. and we didn't know it. We are at war, in case you don't know it. A similar situation exists for us as Christians today, right here in 2017. We do not realize that there is a spiritual battle in our lives. It's December 7, but we are still living as if it was December 6th. Warfare terminology is frequently used to describe the spiritual battle that we face as believers. That warfare terminology used throughout Scripture. Challenge today is prepare for battle. Be on the alert. Be ready for the attack. Oh, the devil is a wily one. Let's pray as we move into the Scripture. Lord, may you just enlighten us and encourage us and remind us, equip us, protect us, strengthen us to be ready for the fight, to stand for the fight that may be going on in our own hearts right now as the devil seeks to distract us and lead us astray and cause us to compromise and to deprioritize you as our God, to have some other treasure besides you in your work, in your plan for us. Oh God, please help us to have the victory. May your word by the Spirit of God be our guide today. In Jesus' name, amen. 4 points this morning. First of all, our strength for the battle. The strength is not our own. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, if you'd look there with me, it says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." It says here in verse 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might." The means of our strength is not our own. We will not be able to face the battles that we face alone. We cannot stand up. We cannot buck up and pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. We must find another source for our strength. We are not strong enough on our own to be victorious. We cannot win on our own. We will fall flat on our face. The devil will have his way with us if we do not lean on the Lord. Strong means to empower or enable. It says here in verse 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might." Be strong in the Lord. To be strong is to be empowered and to be enabled by the Lord. To be strong in the Lord. Strength is from the Lord. Now that's pretty straightforward, isn't it? Because we have a relationship with Him, because we are people that are walking with God, we are yielded to the Spirit, we are praying, and we are in the Word, we are in Christian fellowship, we're doing the things that God has for us to do. And out of that, He empowers us, He enables us to be able to stand against those temptations, those things that would otherwise tear us down and lead us away from the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. The word Lord here speaks of, kurios is the Greek word, one supreme in power. He is the one that is supreme in power. And when we lean on Him, I want to tell you this morning that the enemy is no match for the Lord. And when you are standing with the Lord, when you are walking with the Lord, when you are yielded to the Lord, the enemy is no match. Amen? He's our strength. The Lord will cause us to overcome. And the strength is in His might. strength is in his might, or vigor of his forcefulness could be translated. Vigor of his forcefulness. My brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, in his vigor, in his trying to remember the wording. It's overcoming power is the idea that of what we have. Amen? With the Lord. The power of his might. He invigorates us. Praise his name. How are we going to be able to fight? How are we going to be able to win at Pearl Harbor? How are we going to be able to win when the enemy sneaks in? It's because we are standing in the strength of the Lord. We are prepared because we've already been walking with God. And our defense is up. The Lord, if I drop over right now and I can't finish, I lose my whatever happens, and I can't continue the message, right there is, this is essential. Right there is our hope. Right there is our victory. It is He, the Lord. Don't miss point number one as we talk about a lot of other things, because it is the Lord that is our power. He is our strength. He is our ability to stand and fight because we are connected with Him. If we're neglecting our Bible time, we are growing weaker. If we're neglecting our prayer time, we're growing weaker. If we're neglecting Christian fellowship and church time together to be in the Word, we're losing that strength. We're losing those opportunities to be strong. We need to meditate on the Word of the Lord. How often? Day and night. Morning, noon and night. We need to be thinking of the Word of God. When we wake up in the night, may we meditate and talk with Him. Think of His Word and be people of prayer. Secondly, this morning, not only is our strength and the Lord for the battle, but our struggle in the battle, Scripture talks about here in verse 11. Our struggle in the battle. The devil has wiles. And I found it interesting, as I looked at the Greek word, do you notice anything there about the Greek word methodia? It's the word method. It's our English word method, right? And the devil has some methods that he's using. He has some wiles. He has some plotting. It says here in verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, the plots of the devil. He has a plan. He is plotting against God's people. The same word is used in Ephesians 4:14, the same Greek word, and it's translated lie in wait in Ephesians 4:14. To trick, it's used there in regard to lying in wait to trick or deceive us. See, the devil is sneaking around. He's under the radar. He doesn't want us to know he's there. And if he was to come out, if he attacks us a little bit too hard, you know what we do? We go, oh God, help me, and we start praying more. And he doesn't want us to do that. He just wants to sneak in enough and to start laying one finger, then two on us, and then three. He wants to get his fangs up close enough to start injecting just a little bit of venom to weaken us, to maybe numb up the spot where he really wants to sink his teeth in just a little. He comes in real slow so we don't flinch and jump away. The devil offers the enticement of sin, and he tells us, you can have this without paying the price, which is a lie. It's always a lie. Every sin will be accounted for. Isn't that right? And so the devil is after us with his wiles. And he... some things here, he plotted to tempt Jesus to sin. He had a plot to tempt Jesus. Did it work? And Ephesians 4, Matthew 4, let me just read a few verses here. Kind of brings to light the reality as we think about the temptations. If you want to look there with me, Ephesians 4, 3. It says, now when the tempter came to him, speaking of Jesus, let me read from verse 1, Ephesians 4, 1. Matthew 4:1. I'm sorry. Matthew 4:1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. The Spirit of God led him up there to be tempted. It says that right there. This was a God thing. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterwards, he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. Well, he was hungry. Make these stones bread. Right here, look at these stones. Don't they look like little... Can't you just see it there? Just make them bread. Just go ahead. Get your sinful provision. Looks like a good thing. You need to eat right. And the devil can give us all the arguments of why we should sin and disobey God. But Jesus answered him here in verse 4 and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Wow. Don't get your provisions from the devil. Don't step out and satisfy your own desires. Jesus battled with Scripture. How about verses 5 through 7? Then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple. I wonder how that all is transpiring. And what that looked like, how high it was. And said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, he will give his angels charge over you. And in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone." Go ahead, show that you're powerful. Show that God's for you and that the angels are going to take care of you. Jesus said to him in verse 7, "It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Jesus was using Scripture, and we need to use Scripture when we face temptation. If you have an area where you're struggling, if you have an area where you're tempted, we need to go to the Word of God, go to the toolbox, and find the tool that will meet that need, that will enable us to stand against that temptation, that the devil won't get his hooks into us, that we can just set him aside. Well, because we're focusing on the strength of the Lord. Also, verse 8, it says here in Matthew 4, "Again, the devil took him on an exceeding and high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, 'All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me.' Then Jesus said to him, 'Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve.' Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him." Wow. If Jesus was tempted, if the devil was plotting to take Jesus down and to try and lead him astray with sinful provision or sinful protection or the prestige of people seeing him falling down and then being fine and all, you must be of God, or the sinful power and the protection with all of these things, then don't you think that we're going to be under attack as well, just as the Lord? He plotted to tempt Jesus. And he used the Word of God and thwarted the devil each time. He plots to rob unbelievers of the gospel in Matthew 13, 19. He plots to rob unbelievers of the gospel. That's the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the Word of God, the Word of the kingdom, and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. If you don't know the Lord as your Savior today, beware, beware. Don't put off coming to the Lord. The Bible says, today is the day of salvation. Come to me. Turn ye, the Bible says, right? It says, turn to me. Because the devil wants to snatch away that opportunity for us to be saved. Wants us to turn a deaf ear and a blind eye and a stiff neck to God. Say, no. The devil wants to snatch away our opportunity to be saved. He plots to rob unbelievers of the gospel. Notice also he plots to hinder us in the Lord's work. He plots to hinder us in the Lord's work. Matthew 16, 18 says, "I will build my church," Jesus says, "and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it." And so God has a plan, but the devil is plotting against it. 1 Thessalonians 2, 18. Would you turn? Oh, I got it there in the screen. Just a great verse. 1 Thessalonians 2, 18. "Therefore, we wanted to come to you, even I, Paul, time and again, but Satan hindered us." The devil wants to stop what God wants to do in your life and in this church and in this community. The devil's plotting to stop what he wants to do in your heart. He wants to stop what God desires to do to help you to grow. He wants to turn you aside. He wants to slow you down. He wants to throw a rope around your ankles and trip you up. Paul was planning to do some things, and it goes on that he was able to send Timothy. But Paul wanted to go, but the devil was against him and plotting. He wants to stop God's work. And we need to say, you know what? I know who the enemy is. I know the devil wants me to stop doing these things, but I know they're right. I need to jump in with 2 feet. I need to get after it for God. I need to become dedicated. I need to go on for Him. God help me. Because he plots to hinder the Lord's work. In Acts chapter 13, verse 8 and following, I have several verses here on the screen. "But Emmaus the sorcerer," for so his name is translated, "withstood them, seeking to turn aside the proconsul away from the faith. Then Saul," who also is called Paul, "filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him," you feeling the gaze? "And said, 'O fool of all deceit and all fraud, you son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease perverting the straight ways of the Lord? See, the devil is plotting to stop the Lord's work. He wants to hinder the Lord's work. He wants to slow us down. But let us be dedicated, because the enemy is against us. And when we look at what's going on, we need to realize that we're in a battle. He plots to tempt us to do evil. He plots to tempt us to do evil. He wants us to do wrong. He hinders the believer's unity, fellowship, and ministry. 1 Thessalonians 2:18. I don't have it there. Let me read that. 1 Thessalonians 2:18, if you want to turn there with me. 1 Thessalonians 2:18. Well, that's the verse we just read. Therefore, he wanted to come to you, even I, Paul, time and time again, but Satan hindered us. He wants to tempt us to do evil. He wants to hinder our fellowship. Paul wanted to go and be with the believers there in fellowship. He wanted to be there in unity. He wanted to be there ministering to them. We notice the devil moved Ananias and Sapphira. And I don't know that they were saved. I don't believe that they were. But it says to lie to and to test the Holy Spirit. And so here they're lying to the Holy Spirit. They're testing the Holy Spirit by what they did. And the devil moved them to do this. Notice he also tempted believers at Pergamos to deny Christ and the faith in him in Revelation chapter 2. So the devil has many ploys that he's trying to lead us astray, to deny Christ. He seduced believers at Thyatira to sexual immorality, Revelation 2, 18 to 24. The devil was behind that. He snares to pride and reproach, 1 Timothy 3, 6 and 7. Moves us to pride. These are all things that the devil does to try and lead us astray. Get us proud. Make us a reproach to the name of Christ. 2 Corinthians 2, 10 and 11. He embitters us to be unforgiving. He wants us to not forgive people. He wants us to be bitter. He wants us to hold on to anger. He wants us to hold on to division. Hold on to what people did to us and not give it over to the Lord and not let that go or deal with it. He embitters us. That's the work of the devil. Notice also, you can write down there, he plots to get us to quit. He wants us to quit. He wants us to give up. 1 Thessalonians 3:5. For this reason, when I could no longer endure it, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter had tempted you and our labor might be in vain. That these people would have walked away, that they would quit. The devil would be so happy if today he could get you to quit. If he can get you to back down, if he can get you to slow up in the things of God. We are in a struggle. We are in a battle against the wiles of the devil. This is what he's trying to get us to do. He wants us to quit. He wants us by suffering and discouragement. Notice also the devil will wrestle, verse 12. Verse 12. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities. We're going to look at these. I like the way it says that there. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. That's not the enemy. We're not each other's enemy. And we have division. We work it out because division does come. Challenges come. We get together and we work on those things. We try to do better because I'm not perfect, because we're not perfect. We keep moving forward for God. Amen? God help us to follow His Word, because we're wrestling. And as we think about wrestling, what comes to your mind when you think about wrestling? That's very personal, isn't it? That's a fight. That's if you've ever been a wrestler, right? Or wrestled with your brother or your sister, right? But wrestlers, I mean, it's hot and sweaty, and it's personal, one-on-one. I mean, you couldn't get any closer, and you're just writhing and trying to get the moves and all these things. I wasn't a wrestler that way, but I did wrestle with my brother. Now he's bigger than me. We don't wrestle anymore. Stopped that a long time ago. And we wrestle, though. But the devil wants to overpower us, and he's up against us. He's trying to get us in a headlock. He's trying to get us so we can't move. He's wrestling against us. He's fighting against us, and it's not easy. We like to sit back and just relax, you know, kick up our feet, and it's so good. But the devil's after us, and it takes Christian passion to to keep after it for God, because we're wrestling. Wrestle is literally to sway, vibrate. And I kept trying to think about that, and I just thought about two wrestlers. They're swaying, and they're trying to, and it's an intense struggle of might, skill, and strength, and endurance. The devil's had a lot of practice with wrestling, with his plots, with his ploys, with his wiles. He's had a lot of experience over the centuries. He knows how to get after us. Maybe he knows our personal weaknesses. But let us continue to wrestle, not just give in. Okay, take me. No. Keep wrestling. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. You see, he has workers. The devil has others that are working with him. Not flesh and blood, but against principalities. It's not your spouse. It's not your kids. It's not your parents. It's not your boss. It's not your neighbor. It's not fellow believers. Not really flesh and blood. We are fighting against evil in this world. The devil has fallen angels or demons, other fallen angels that fell with him that we're fighting against. Principalities is chief in rank or rule. Those that are chief in rank, that's who we're wrestling against. Some people that are up there in the hierarchy, the chiefs. We can look back to the book of Daniel and find out more of that. Against the powers, which speaks of authorities, or in 1 Corinthians 8, 9, it's translated the same Greek word, jurisdiction. They're over their realm. They're over their jurisdiction. Okay, there's principalities. There's powers. There's the rulers of the darkness of this age. Literally, a world ruler. The world rulers. You see, Satan has it organized. He's working his plan. He's trying to tear down and destroy. And he's coming after you, and he's coming after me. He's coming after Heritage Baptist Church. He's trying to stop God's work, but God's greater. And when we go in the power of the Lord and his might, we're overcomers. Against spiritual hosts of wickedness or demonic plots. Demonic plots that he has against us, those spiritual hosts. Against spirits in heavenly places. Heavenly means above the sky. So it's not down here where the real battle lies. It's up above. It's up in the heavens. It's that spiritual realm that's going on out there and in the hearts of men and with leaders. Ephesians 2 says, "And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you were once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air." That's who we followed before we were saved. But when we are born again, we're no longer following the prince of the power of the air. We're no longer following the devil. We're no longer following the world's ways that are rebellious against God and self-willed and self-pleasing and full of pleasure. We are now about the Lord. And we have his true pleasures of peace and joy and purpose and walking with him. Praise his name. We have his love set upon us. Find also, thirdly, the preparation for battle. The preparation for battle. How do we prepare for battle? It's our responsibility to put on the armor. Look at verse 11. Put on the armor, the whole armor of God. Put on the whole armor of God. Look also down in verse 13. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God. It's our responsibility. This is what we are to be doing. It's our responsibility to put it on. It's our responsibility to have it all on. All of it. The complete, the full armor. Now, this is where we need to examine ourselves. How am I doing with having a complete, full set of armor? Am I going into battle with just a couple of pieces on? I wonder what would have happened had at Pearl Harbor there if the warnings there from the northern part of the island had been taken heed of. How differently things might have been. And we need to have the whole set of armor on and take that warning. It's to our benefit. Verse 13, therefore take the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. We've done all that we can, and then we're going to stand in the power of his might. It's to our benefit. You want the devil to yank the rug out from under you? You want the devil to give you regret and shame and hurt? Draw us into sexual immorality where we're going to be like a crust of bread? We're worth nothing? And our wealth and honor is taken away? You want the devil to have his way with us? No, we don't. So we stand and we fight against that. It's in our practical living. It's in our practical living that we prepare. This isn't something that is out there in some oblivious kind of a spiritual dimension that we kind of a meditating thing on. None of that. This is right where we live. This is how we live our lives. This is a very practical thing, how we're going to face the day today and tomorrow. Do we have the belt of truth? Verse 14. Verse 14. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth. Now, in those days, they had robes and so forth and different type of bathrobe type clothing, you know, that hang down. So they'd tie it off with the belt. It would kind of keep everything in place. And sort of like if you have a tool or so forth, that a tool pouch, that kind of, you kind of hang that on your belt and that kind of a thing. So it all kind of brought everything together. And if they were going to be running, they'd take that robe up and they'd tuck it in the belt, and then they could run. They wouldn't be tripping up on things. But we need to be belted with what? Truth. Is our life permeated with truth? And the truth comes from the Word of God. Are we thinking about the truth? Are we reading the truth of the Word? I mean, we can read a lot of magazines. We can read a lot of Facebook. We can read a lot of emails. We can read a lot of those links. We can read a lot of, see a lot of TV programming and all of this stuff. But where do we get truth? A lot of stuff can overwhelm us and use our time. But if we are not getting the belt of truth that's going to hold us together, we're going to be ill-equipped for battle. We need to stay in the Word. We need to meditate on the Word. We need to memorize the Word. We need to think on the Word. Make the Word part of us. Be belted about with truth. Be righteous in living, I called it. This is the breastplate. And I've called it that. You can write what you want. This is my take on it. Stand therefore having your waist, girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate, righteous living, that we're going to cover our vital organs, our heart and our vital organs, that we'll have the breastplate of living right, that we're going to be protected because we're doing the right thing, righteous living, choosing right, the breastplate of righteousness, so the devil can't say, you did it, you dirty scoundrel, and now our heart is weeping. We are so ashamed, we are so broken because he got some licks on us and we let him. We let him lead us astray. We took off the breastplate of doing what was right, and now we're the one hurting for it. Now we're ashamed. Now we ruined our testimony. Now whatever it is, oh God, help us to keep right living, choosing right, the breastplate of righteousness on, belted around with the truth, what is true and righteous. Also, be prepared to carry the gospel good news. Verse 15. Be prepared. It says, now, read this. Look at this with me. Verse 15. And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So you're prepared with the gospel. Prepared for the gospel good news to get that out there. Because we're thinking about the cross. We're looking back to the cross where we were saved. We're looking back to what Jesus did for us, remembering him next Sunday's Lord's table. And remembering him. But we're prepared to carry that gospel because that's what saved us. And we want to tell other people, because if people don't have the Lord, we can talk to that man at the gas station. We can talk to that hairdresser. We can talk to so-and-so, our neighbor. But if we never take them the gospel and they never hear the gospel, how are they going to be saved? We need to get around to not only building relationships, but talking to them about Jesus. Have you ever asked the Lord to be your Savior? Has anybody ever showed you from the Bible how you can be saved? Just ask somebody that. What do you think about Jesus? Let me tell you what I think. Let me tell you what Jesus did in my life. Can I share John 3:16 with you? You know what the Bible says? It's amazing. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Now, whoever, that means me, that means you. Talk to him about Jesus. Just talk to him about the real thing. Be prepared to carry the gospel. As we think about our feet being shod with that good news, Zondervan says this, that the military successes both of Alexander the Great and of Julius Caesar were due in large measure to their armies being well shod, their feet, right, and thus able to undertake long marches at incredible speed over rough terrain. Victory. They would take several layers of leather put together, And they would put some, at times, different ones. They'd have spikes sticking out of there. How do you design these things, right? But they'd put this all together and they'd strap them on, and man, they could go. They could move through brush. They could move through water, slippery stones. They could move through whatever it is. Because their feet were covered, their feet were protected, it didn't slow them down. And we need to be about the gospel. And we're going to be able to be moving forward when we're prepared to share the gospel. Because the devil's not going to be tempting us with his trinkets. We're going to be thinking about the cross. We're going to be thinking about Jesus and how people need to be saved. And we're going to be getting that message out. Be constantly reliant on Christ. I've called it the shield of faith. Verse 16. And isn't it interesting, it says now, powerful words, above all. Taking the shield of faith. Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. The dart of suicide. The dart of self-reliance. The dart of you're no good. The dart of discouragement. The dart of hopelessness. The dart of sorrow. The list goes on and on. He shoots his arrows at us, and we hold up the shield of faith. We're having faith in God. I'm trusting you, Jesus. You saved me. I'm your child. We're trusting the Lord. Oh, God, you're preparing a place for me. Oh, God, you promised me you'll never leave me. We're trusting by faith what the Word of God has said, wrapping that truth around us, living righteously, and trusting God, that shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the evil one. Aren't you glad every dart can be stopped? We don't have to be hit. We don't have to be lit up. We don't have to be injured. We're trusting God, and the enemy is set back on his heel because God is with us. Amen? We're winners for the name of Christ's sake. Praise his name. Be constantly reliant and be settled in and mindful of our salvation is the way I've thought of the helmet of salvation. I pondered that. What does it mean let's read what it says in verse 17. What does this mean? And take the helmet of salvation. What does that mean? I called it that. Be settled in and mindful of our salvation. Our head, that's where our brain is. That's where we think. And our head is covered saying, I am saved. I am God's child. Nothing is going to stop the Father from taking care of me. No man can pluck me out of Christ's hand. And I'm hid in Christ, and I'm the Father's hand as well, and I'm sealed with the Holy Spirit. The down payment of the Holy Spirit's been given. I am His, and I'm a winner. It's about salvation. Our head is controlled by salvation. Where I've come as a sinner, I met Christ at the cross, and I'm going on, and I'm headed for home in glory. It's about salvation. He began a good work in me. He is continuing a good work in me, and one day He's going to complete the good work. Is your head about that? Are you looking for the Lord's return? Is Jesus coming back one of these times? Every day that passes, it is getting a day closer. He's coming back. It's getting close, folks. We need to be ready. The world is looking like it more and more. Israel's back in the land. The EC's over there. We got Russia in the north. We got trouble in Syria. We got Turkey. Stuff's going on. The mark of the beast is possible today. They can put an implant in your hand where you got to be scanned in your forehead. It's possible. It wasn't possible 50 years ago, 100 years ago. We need to be looking to the Lord, our mind, the helmet of salvation on. Lastly, our advancement in battle. How do we advance? Notice what it says, our advancement in battle. Use the Word of God here in verse 17. It says, take the helmet of salvation. Now, these are all defensive pieces of armor until now, it says, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Just like Jesus used the Word of God to drive back the devil, so the Word of God will help us for a defense and advancement. When we share the Word of God with others, we are invading Satan's realm. And God's Word is powerful. It's the seed. It is the living water that will bring change in other people's lives. Use the Word of God. It is for advancement. And also we need to communicate with the Lord in prayer. So verse 17 says, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So here we're praying. Praying in accordance with God's will, in accordance with the Spirit of God, what God wants for us. And then the last part of the verse talks about we're praying for others. I want to ask you, are you praying for me as your pastor? I need your prayers. I'm in a battle. The devil's trying to yank the rug out from under me. Right? We need to pray for one another. The devil's trying to yank the rug out. The devil's trying to get some fiery darts in. The devil's trying to take us out, slow us down, trip us up. He's trying to do all in a wily manner. He's got a plot. He's sneaking around. If he was to pop up right here and scare us all to death, if we could see him for who he truly was, I mean, we'd be, right? We'd be praying. We'd be in the Bible. We'd just be like, you know, God help us, right? But he's real, but he's sneaking around, but he's just as much real, even though he's sneaking around. We need to take spiritual battle seriously and look up. Support one another in prayer. Communicate with the Lord in prayer for ourselves, but then support one another in prayer as well. Are you advancing in the battle? God help us to have strength for the battle. No, oh, I guess we're not done yet. Support one another in comfort. This is the last couple verses there. Let me just read a couple more. But that you also may know my affairs, how I am doing, Tychicus, my beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, will make all things known to you, whom I have sent to you for this very purpose, that you may know our affairs and that he may comfort your hearts. Hey, as we're in the battle together, let's support one another with comfort. Let's comfort one another. You know, people are beaten and bloodied out there. There's a lot of hate and a lot of harm in the world, a lot of misuse, a lot of selfish ways. And we just got to be there to help each other along sometimes. Not a one of us in here that we couldn't get a marker board and put each of our names down and write something next to it that's a burden that we carry, a challenge that we face. We need to pray and support and comfort one another in the battle. You know, we don't shoot fellow soldiers, do we? Is that what they would do in battle? No, you take care. You help each other heal and get back up. And the church isn't a showcase for saints. The church is a hospital for sinners. We're here to help one another. Because we're in a battle, we need to support and comfort one another. Are you prepared for battle? Our strength comes where? From the Lord. Thank you, Lord, you're providing strength. Our struggle is what? The devil. He's plotting against you. It's not people. Let's not get off on that. Our preparation is where? Us. Putting on the armor. That's up to us to do. And so let's keep working on those points. And the advancement comes where? From the Word and prayer. Would you stand with me as we close in prayer this morning? Lord, we want to thank you that you care for us. That you have laid it out quite clearly where the battle lies. We're reminded afresh this morning that there is an organized host of fallen angels, demons, Satan and demons, our adversaries, the devil, the father of lies, that old dragon, the serpent that wants to stop your work, and he hates us because you love us, because we're trying to promote your work. And we're asking that you'll continue to help us to do those things that you would have for us to do, and drawing strength regularly and constantly, daily, drawing upon your enabling to do the things that we do, that we would prepare for battle and be prepared regularly to keep going on, and that we would advance by using the Word and by prayer and by mutual comfort and encouragement to one another. We ask that you would help us as a church, help our pastor and deacons, help our committee chairs, help our teachers, help our brothers and sisters here today, that we would just continue to walk together, even though trials and challenges and troubles do come, that we would work them out, that we would walk together in unity with a passion for Jesus and for the gospel and for faith and for the truth and for salvation, that we would keep pushing on for the Word of God, for the testimony of Jesus Christ, that this fellowship that we call Heritage Baptist Church, meeting here at this location, that we the people would keep pushing forward because we're resisting the plots and ploys of the deceiver. And may you get the glory. May you receive the praise. May people continue to come to you for salvation and growth then, that we'd all be disciples to take the next step in obedience to you, to stay strong. Lord, just bless marriages here today. Help those with various burdens upon their heart for finance, for employment, for health. Pray for Heather, Lord, that you would help her with her continued healing. Lord, others, for Glenn and others, Lord, just have your hand upon our brothers and our sisters. Oh, God, be with Bob and Melanie today. And for Beth, Lord, bless her. And Lord, just the challenges are great, Lord, but you are a mighty God. Just be with our congregation today. Meet each need. Comfort each one here. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you and have a good afternoon. Thank you.